Coming up on Spotlight this week, I'll be talking exclusively to Louis Walsh. We'll be hearing from Emma Stone and Emma Thompson, and we've fabulous fashion from Pamela Scott.
Spotlight in association with Space 2. Sponsored by GLAM DOLL, bringing Hollywood home.
Welcome back to season two of Spotlight with me, Lisa Cannon, here in the Gaiety Theatre, brought to you by GLAM DOLL, bringing Hollywood home. X Factor judge Louis Walsh talks exclusively to me about the trappings of fame and cutting his teeth in the music industry as a tea boy in the late 80s among Ireland's famous show bands.
So you did the tea and you did all the things we all have done.
I did Red Hurley's white suits, I did all the fan mail, I used to do all the posters, answer the phone. It was Red Hurley and the Nevada and the Royal Show Band and the Royal Blues, and it was a great buzz in Holkham Street, and they were big stars then.
We have fashion from Pamela Scott with stylist Aoife Carty. We've autumn trends to suit any shape and occasion. And let's hear what Emma Stone and Emma Thompson, the stars of Cruella, have to say about their villainous roles, which is currently streaming exclusively on Disney Plus.
Well done, Disney. You were brilliantly supportive in to make something that hasn't been done before.
X Factor judge and music manager Louis Walsh is on to the next project since the X Factor came to a close. He has blazed a trail in pop music management, masterminding some of the biggest boy bands in the world. I sat down exclusively with Louis at Space 2 for an in-depth, candid insight into his incredible career to date. Buckle up for wit and great advice from Louis Walsh, like you've never heard him before. Louis, what a sight to see you. I'm so thrilled. Welcome to Space 2.
This is lovely, and it's great you have your own show at last.
Thank you. We were joking outside.
No, but Lisa, it's great, and it's good to see you, because I know you're from Mayo, and that's all great.
Absolutely. Castlebar woman, Kilchimar.
Castlebar, same thing.
Absolutely.
You know who we are? We're real cultures.
Underneath it all.
And that's a good thing.
I know. Oh, Louis, do you know what? Even having you here, you know, it's been such a long time, hasn't it? A year and a half. Global pandemic. I mean, have you been outside the door much, or how have you been?
Honestly, Lisa, I've been in Dublin. I haven't been out much, but I've enjoyed a lot of the time off.
Yeah.
Because I've been reading and watching Netflix and just catching up on music and getting new ideas. And, you know, I love Dublin at the moment.
You're
I
taking time out, which is nice, because you've had such a busy schedule. I can only imagine your phone must be ringing all the time, the emails pinging, and finally, there's a little bit of calm, oasis.
That's when I was doing X Factor, because I did that for like 15 years.
I know.
And I was in the airport every week, and it was great fun.
Too much though, I think. You know, there's a point, even when I did Exposé all that time, you know, you just want to get away and have a little bit of a break from it all, you know, rather than all that constant flying.
I liked it because it was like a big reality show, and every day was different. And I love working with Simon Cowell, you see, and Sharon Osbourne and Nicole. And I love nearly all the judges. Not all of them, but I love most of them.
Most of them. I suppose in terms of the pandemic, like I was thinking about what way I could phrase this question, because to be honest, the music industry has been crushed.
Yeah.
No gigs are playing.
No
People
gigs.
Are very upset. I mean, I know, you know, we have a roadmap on how the performing arts is going to get back to some level of normalcy, even gigs. But, you know, obviously you working in the music industry so long, I mean, poor Christy Dignam is saying he's down to his last 2,000 euro. Is he even going to be able to pay his mortgage?
Oh.
What is going to happen to the music industry after all that's happened?
Well, it's coming back slowly now, I think.
I think
it's gonna. I see a light at the end of the tunnel. I really do. I think next year is gonna be so busy with gigs.
There's
gonna be
gigs
every week. Everyone's gonna be touring. All the big names. Yeah.
Okay.
So I think it's going to be okay.
I want to kind of ricochet right back to the mid-80s or kind of...
Go on.
Right back now, right back. You know, I know that you worked, was Pembroke Street with Tommy
Pembroke Road. No, I started off in Holkham Street.
Okay.
There was a band from Mayo called the Royal Blues, Doc Carr and the Royal Blues, and I knew them. And I was like a fan. Okay. And they were like a big band in Mayo at the time. They had a song called Old Man Trouble. And they were big, name. And I got to know them. And Doc Carl said, come on the road. And I was like a roadie for them, going around doing things, learning the game. And their manager was a guy called Tommy Hayden in Dublin. And Doc Carl said to me, I'm going to get you into his office to learn the business. And he did.
That's brilliant.
Which was an amazing thing for someone from Mayo to do. He was from Ballinrobe, Doc Carl.
So you did the tea and you did all the things we all have done.
I did Red Hurley's white suits. I did all the fan mail. I used to do all the posters, answer the phone. It was Red Hurley and the Nevada and the Royal Show Band and the Royal Blues. And it was a great buzz in Holcombe Street. And they were big stars then.
Do you look back at that time as a fond memory? Because I know, like, half the things I did even to get into this industry, I had to do free teas and coffees, you know, waiting in sets and waiting for things to happen. I mean, wasn't that a joy, though? It's an old way of learning your stripes.
It's the only way to learn. You start at the bottom and you kind of claw your way to the top, a bit like you've done.
Yeah. And it's true. It's true. You have to earn your stripes, I think.
No, you have to. And you have to earn the bottom. And you don't want anything for nothing, you know. Yeah. So I love the show bands. I learned an awful lot from them.
When you do remember the show bands, like, did Tommy kind of, you know, I know Jerry Ryan was signed at the time. I think Mark Cagney was signed at the time.
All the DJs were there as well. Yeah. That was a different thing. But I was into the music. And I used to manage people like Johnny Logan, Linda Martin and Chips, The Freshmen. They were brilliant live bands. There was no miming. It was all live. It was brilliant. Yeah. And the show bands don't get the credit they deserve, really.
I don't think so either. And I think, you know, when I speak to my father at times or have spoken to him about things, you know, he remembers, you know, the Indians,
the music,
all the bands from then and that era. And I was looking back at old pictures of you and seeing you in The Traveller's Friend in Castlebar with Linda Martin.
Yeah.
And, you know, I really
and
feel...
And Johnny Logan.
Yeah. You know, they're the late 80s. But I think, you know, we talk about earning our stripes, but I think, you know, Louis, now, if there was a young manager watching this spotlight and thinking to myself, I want to be the next Louis Walsh, is there anywhere for them to learn how to become a manager and an agent?
Yeah, they start in a record company, they start with MCD, they start with any band on the road, doing gigs, learning. There's no easy way. You just got to get out there and do it.
What makes a good manager, though?
I think you have to care. I mean, I remember Paul McGuinness. He was working very close beside us in Pembroke Road, and he had this band called U2. Nobody cared about them. Nobody cared about them except him. And I remember going to gigs in the bag, and there was like maybe 30 or 40 people, but he believed in them, and he got Island Records, and he made that band happen. So you just got to believe in what you're selling. That's really it.
That's really good advice.
But that's all you have to believe in. Yeah. And if you believe in it, other people are going to get into it, you know. I remember when I went in to see Paul Keough in Polydor Universal in Ireland, and I was doing Boyzone, and he thought I was crazy. He really did. And maybe he was right. But he knew I was enthusiastic, and that's why he signed them. He said it wasn't the band I signed. He said, I signed your enthusiasm, and you cannot buy that.
You know, even looking at your cash and calibre, my goodness, of all the people you've managed, I mean, Jedward, you know, JLS.
I prefer not to mention Jedward, honestly.
We won't mention
them. Because I wanted to be in the music game. Forget about that.
Okay.
But like Westlife, massive. Doing a massive tour next year. Going to sell stadiums, you know. Boyzone did really well. Girls Aloud did well. Ronan Keating did well once. Samantha Mumba, you know, I work with Lulu. I work with loads of people.
You've really, you know, you're the one that's kind of the puppet master behind the scenes that pushes the talent through. And I suppose in a way, obviously you have to believe in every single one, but when is it time to look at the act and say, well, I'm pulling the plug or I'm walking away as a manager. You know, I've done it my best. I've done enough. When does that hard call come?
When the crowds drop off.
Oh, right.
When the money stops rolling in, you move on to something else, because you can only do so much. I do songs. I'm really good with songs. Mm-hmm. I think that's the best thing about me as a manager. I'm always finding songs. I'm always finding songwriters and producers. And I've done that in the last 2 months, especially with Westlife. And we've got some brilliant new songs for the album. And we've got new writers. And we're kind of changing the whole music. For me, it's all about the songs. Nothing else matters.
Let's talk a little bit about Westlife. I was going to talk about them later, but let's kick off there, because obviously you've got new music and new material.
New
happening
album,
from
ready
new
to
album,
go.
Everything.
Some great
I mean, how
writers.
Exciting is it to bring them back and have them in the foray yet again?
They have a massive, massive fan base, you know, and they're going to sell out Wembley Stadium, not just the arena, the stadium next year. They're going to go to Cork. They're going to be everywhere. And I really believe the new music is great.
Yeah.
I'm not just saying that as a manager. I think the new album is really strong. Lisa, there's a lot of Irish talent out there. Mm-hmm. Look at Picture This, look at Codaline, look at Hosier, look at Dermot Kennedy.
Lyra, we had Lyra on season one.
Lyra is on the up. you know, but the other acts are all selling universally. Lyra, I love.
You quoted, actually, I think, one in newspaper a while back, you said people have to pay a price to become famous. I mean, that's true. I know all my years interviewing celebrities, I mean, I've heard some very sad stories. What big of a price is price of fame, and is it worth it?
They know what they're getting into. They want to be famous, you know, and being famous is not all it's made out to be, you know.
True.
I'm in for the, I like
not
the
that
business.
I know, I'm talking but internationally.
I like the business, but, you know, if you become famous, everybody wants a bit of you. You lose your personal life. You lose a certain amount, but you make a lot of money, and that's, if that's what you want, if you want to be famous. If you want that lifestyle, it's fine, but you have to know, and you have to be ready for it, and you need the good people around you. You know what you need? A really good lawyer, a really good accountant.
Accountant.
A really good manager and a really good partner. And if you got all those, you're in the right place, you know, because they'll all keep you grounded.
Really good advice there about the music industry from Louis, a man who has over 40 years experience. Well, stay with us in part two of the interview when he has this to say about his legacy.
I just want to enjoy life. I'm not looking for a legacy or anything.
Okay.
I just want to be happy and enjoy it as long as I can.
Spotlight is on fashion now with Pamela Scott, who have some versatile and gorgeous autumn winter looks to suit your shape and your budget. Stylist Aoife Carty is on hand to talk us through three stylish looks. Nice to have you back on the Gaiety stage, Aoife.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm delighted to
be
back.
It's great to see you. Now, of course, the weather has changed. We're into kind of September time now, so we're looking at those autumnal colours. And you have Pamela Scott, who's a family brand, synonymous around the country, of course, as well. Very big fashion brand.
Yeah, I think everyone knows Pamela Scott. It's like a really famous Irish-owned brand. So they have stores nationwide and online, and I think everyone knows who they are now. They've been in the business over 50 years. They're actually a family-run business. It's not the usual kind of Pamela look style. It's quite different, which I'm really excited about. They've gone with some really kind of trending really pieces for autumn winter, which is really
cool.
Yeah,
they've kind of changed their looks up a little bit, haven't they, and their style.
Now
it's quite unique because you've got a gorgeous blazer for us today and a really cool dress. You've kind of teamed those lovely autumnal colours together.
Yeah, I really like this outfit. So my first look on Yumiko is this gorgeous printed dress. So it's got gorgeous orange, browns and blue colours in it. So lovely kind of transitional colours for coming into autumn winter. And it's got a lovely elasticated waist, which I think is really nice and kind of comfy. And it's got lovely kind of sleeves with little ruffles on sleeves and then on the bottom, which is a nice kind of layering effect. And then for over, I've put a lovely blazer on it. So the dress is only $49.99 and then the blazer is €86, which I think is really good for the quality.
Yeah,
the quality is amazing. And I think it's just a blazer especially, you can have that and you can wear it so many ways. Like, it's very versatile.
Now, of course, they have teamed up with Vogue Williams for this blazer.
Yeah, so this is a little miss Stress X Vogue Williams edit blazer. So Pamela Scott's actually have loads of brands, so this is one of the many brands they have. They're all online if you want to have a little look.
Okay. And the oversize is something that you now have obviously teamed for us today. I'm not familiar with the oversize team.
So oversized blazer is like really popular. It's really popular for summer and I think that's going to continue on into winter. So it's kind of handy because it's just like comfortable look, it's quite flattering. Like, people have been wearing it as like oversized blazer dresses, oversized blazer with jeans, like it really kind of goes with a lot.
And you've nice boots as well to match.
Yeah, I do, actually I love these boots. So I think a lovely pair of dressy boots is really good for if you want to wear this out on night out or something. So they're kind of snake print chocolate boots, which I think are kind of pretty. They tie in with like the browns and the dress, so it's quite complimentary.
Indeed, now of course, Pamela Scott's great size wise, we go up to a size 22, I believe, in Pamela
Scott. Which is quite rare, I think, size 22 all the way from size 8, I think that's really good.
It's good, so comfortable sizes for all women, shapes and sizes. So we've got a lovely look here today, a trench.
Yeah, so I've kind of gone for the second look, it's quite more casual look. So I've gone for a trench because I think trench is like a timeless piece. And it's really a good piece to have because I think you can go from autumn where it's quite like, it's kind of humid and then you can layer it all the way into winter. So you can put on your jumper and like few more like layering pieces on underneath. And then I have this with the lovely chocolate brown jumper. The quality of this jumper is so nice and it's just so, so comfy. I really like this. And then I've tied it in with some flare denim jeans. I think the flares are coming back. So.
Thank God. Everyone always says to me that they're not, but I'm so glad you brought them in today. I love them.
I think they're fab. They're just so flattering on. I think they're really cool. And they're kind of coming back in style. And then I've just got some brown boots again. I think the brown boots are kind of cool and they look really nice with the jumper.
Of course, so you've got kind of a nice casual look with great price points there for us. Yeah. And then moving on to our final look. Now, this is my favorite of all the three, the kimono. It's back.
Yeah, it's cool, isn't it? I love the colors in this kimono. So we've got a really nice floral kimono with the little kind of black velvet edging, so it's stunning on Yumiko here. So I've just teamed this with some black palazzo pants. They're really nice, kind of airy on your legs, and then you've got a black vest underneath, and then I just teamed it with some black heels just for
more going out piece, really.
Yeah, kind of going out.
Things are kind of opening back up again. I think you can definitely wear this for meeting, you know, for lunch with the girls, or an evening look as well. It's kind of day to night, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. I kind of want to dress it up just because the colours in the kimono are so fab. I think it'd be nice for me.
What I love about a kimono is the fact that obviously if you're slightly larger or if you're, you know, up and down slightly like I always am, I think it really is kind of a piece that you can wear in your wardrobe all throughout the year.
Yeah, it is. It's a really nice kimono. I love the colours in it. I think it's just a fab piece.
Easy
all year
piece.
Round.
Indeed. Yeah, exactly. If anyone wants to see all those looks, where do they go?
PamelaScott.com is where to go, and you can shop these looks in store and online.
Okay, Aoife, lovely to have you back in the Gaiety Stage.
Thank you so much for me.
In another couple of weeks.
See you then. Thanks.
The spotlight is now on streaming with Cruella. Yes, even after its huge success in cinemas and its release on Disney Plus, Cruella is continuing to hit the high notes with viewers on the small screens. Spotlight hears what Emma Stone and Emma Thompson have to say about taking on such villainous roles.
They say there are five stages of grief. Well, I'd like to add one more. Revenge.
I had a kind of interest and fascination with what the backstory of a character like Cruella de Vil would be. And I first heard about the notion of creating that story when I was doing La La Land. So it couldn't have been further from the idea of Cruella de Vil. So I was very intrigued at the idea of what makes a villain and playing someone like that, because it was so far from anything that I had ever gotten to play before. So I think, and that was what attracted me.
Do you have a light?
I'd always wanted to work with Em, and we knew each other a bit, and we just knew that we would have a great time. We didn't know quite how great a time we were going to have. And so it was truly one of the greatest joys of my professional career has been working with Lost Stone, but also with the costumes and the makeup in this movie, designed by respectively Jenny Bevan and Naomi Dunn, were extraordinary. I mean, I've never really, I think, done a movie where 50% at least of the character work has been done by the artists working in those fields, who are both at the top of their game and they've been doing it a long time, like I have. And so it was wonderful to be with this exceptional group of women, all just doing their best work, and also with a wonderful script, which is a redemption story told backwards, which is about two women at work and at each other's throats. And it's not a story I've ever seen. I've never seen that before. So well done, Disney, who were brilliantly supportive to make something that hasn't been done before, that's truly original and thrillingly dark and dynamic and feisty and fierce and fun.
I'm starting to remember you have a bit of an extreme side.
Louis Walsh told me earlier in the show about how, like many others in the music and film industry, he has earned his stripes and climbed that greasy ladder of success. But in the second part of my very candid and heartfelt chat with the X Factor judge, he reveals why fame isn't a good thing and why he's intent on living his best life. Take a look.
What's great about your life, maybe, I'm only just speculating, is the fact that you kind of get the best of both worlds. Because obviously everybody, when you came in here, everyone's like, oh, hi, Louis. Everyone loves to chat to you.
People know me from TV.
And they know you from TV.
And I'm approachable, you know.
Well, this is it. But at the same time, you can still walk the street to come up here and say hello to us, you know. You're not bombarded to the point where
you can't. People talk to me. But it's like, I never wanted to be famous. It was Simon Cowell that put me on TV. You know, and meeting Simon did change an awful lot of things for me because I'd done Boyzone, I'd done Girls Aloud, and he put me on this massive big TV show with him and Sharon Osbourne, and nobody knew me, you know.
But how did that feel at the beginning to kind of, well, I suppose you had to put your flag in the sand and say, I'm Irish and I'm going to make a difference and make this my own, which you did on
It was scary. It was really scary, but he always protected me, you know, and we had great fun on The X Factor. They didn't always get on very well, Simon and Sharon.
No, I know.
And I was in the middle trying to get them to talk to each other. But they're very similar. That's the problem. It's like two queen bees, you know, in the same hive. It doesn't work.
Okay, you know? Okay.
But he was great to me. He was great. I had the best time doing that show.
You really seem to have a very strong bond between Simon and yourself. And I know, obviously, you know, he credited to putting you on a platform that the whole globe can see. And then alongside Nicole Scherzinger came in and Danny Minogue. Loads of people were in there.
Nicole and Cheryl and Talisa and blah, blah, blah. We had everybody on.
Who was your favourite lineup?
I liked working with Simon and Sharon. Because I knew them, and when it's three people, it's very easy. When it's four, it's a little bit harder. And you do. We weren't really in competition. And Lisa, we never knew the votes. People think
did
we
you
all
not?
Never, never,
oh, I thought
ever,
you did know the
ever.
Votes.
We never knew the votes. We never knew our categories. We never knew who was in the bottom two, ever. I wish we did.
I thought you did.
No, and I think that's what made the show real. It was real.
No, it was very real.
And we never knew who was going to walk in, whether it was going to be like the Chicken Man, it was going to be Leona Lewis. Were they going to be really good or really bad or crazy?
You know, you won. Was it, what year was that? Was that two?
I won second year with Shane Ward.
That's right.
Who was great to work with. And then I had JLS in the final.
That's right.
And, you know, and I wanted them to win. And you know what Simon did? He got Beyonce to do a duet with Alexander Brooks. That was it.
That murdered it
then,
didn't it?
But they've had a great career, JLS. You don't have to win the show. Look at Rylan, you know?
Absolutely, or One Direction, of course.
One Direction, stars. Look at Little Mix. The last big girl band and the last big boy band came from X Factor.
In terms of yourself, obviously, Sharon Osbourne and you, I know, have a great bond as well. And I know that you sometimes get over to Miami. I know you've property there and you enjoy your time. Will you see yourself going over again now that obviously the world is hopefully opening up a little bit more? Will you travel a bit more?
I've booked the very first flight out.
Oh!
They stopped all the direct flights and they start in December. I'm on the very first one to Miami.
You're on to Miami. And why do you enjoy Miami? Like, is it obviously getting away from the Irish weather and having a nice time?
I just don't like the winter here. And I love being there because I know the place now. And I know all the nice restaurants and it's bright and the sea. And it's just a different vibe.
It's a different vibe.
I wouldn't want to live there. I like living here.
Because I always wondered, were you ever going to just completely, you know, up move and sticks and live in America?
No, why not? America.
Yeah.
The largest open air asylum in the world. Look who's running it. I mean, come on.
When I hear Donald Trump's voice,
I just turn off the TV. Now when I hear Joe Biden, I turn off the TV. And Boris Johnson. They're the three worst voices for me, ever.
In terms of...
I've heard a lot of people on that. They're the worst people. I just don't want to know about them. I don't believe them.
Do you switch off when it comes to politics and news? Or do you kind of engage, let it soak in a bit?
No. You know my favourite channel? I'm glued to CNN. I've CNN on 24/7. I know every presenter, every reporter on it. Yeah. It's an amazing channel and I watch it and when I see what's happening in Haiti and Afghanistan, we're so lucky.
We don't realise it. No, we don't. And I think just in everything that's happening with the global crisis, of course, with climate change, Haiti.
Everything. Fires.
Fires, like Afghanistan. Everything that's going on, you know, please God, you know, things will return to normal and
they
we will have a bit more of a life.
But this is a great little island. We forget how good it is. It's great.
In terms,
you know why?
Yeah.
I feel safe here. I feel absolutely safe here.
What about your Mayo connection? I presume you're very proud of it, and where you come from, a huge family.
Nine, and I'm second oldest.
Yeah.
Seven boys, two girls.
I mean, going back to what we talked about being a manager, do you think that's really helped you in order to do what you're doing, because you came from such a large family?
Came from nothing. And because I went to all the ballrooms in Ireland, especially in Mayo, there were so many. Mm. And that was my training. And I loved it, and I love listening to music. And I started by, I love music, you see, and I've always been buying records and, you know, DVDs and CDs, and I've got an amazing collection of vinyl. But I really love all kinds of music. It's not just pop music.
Who's your favourite artist then, in terms of the overall? Or do you have a few? You have a few, I would imagine.
I play Roy Orbison and Patsy Cline, Van Morrison. I play a lot of old people. Dusty Springfield, I can go on forever.
I wanted to talk a little bit about Colin Farrell, because obviously, sure, look, we all renownedly know that he never got into Boyzone, but I mean, obviously his career took off in a different direction. What was interesting was you did say in print that you wouldn't mind him playing you in a movie. And I thought, well, that's good.
No, but he's fun. He's a really nice guy. He's one of the down-to-earth people. He hasn't changed at all. Anytime I see him, we have a laugh.
Yeah.
He deserved to make it.
Do you think there could be a movie in that? Like a movie about Boyzone and kind of...
About a boy band that made it that shouldn't have made it, you mean?
Like
The Commitment. It's like The Commitment. Yeah, it would work.
I think it could work. Then the sidekick who didn't get into the band became an A-list celebrity.
And I told him he was wasting his time.
Golden Globe star.
He said to me, I don't really want to do the singing, man. I want to be an actor. And I said, Colin, you're wasting your time. It's too hard.
Well, the difference is, I suppose, the music industry is tough, but then I suppose acting is even tougher. But to make it and make it at the level that
make
he did
it
is incredible.
You know, a lot of people can make it in music or in movies and have one or two hits. But to have a long career like he has, constantly working, great movies. He's brilliant.
What would you really like to do when it comes to the next chapter of Louis Walsh?
I'd like to do something new. I want to have auditions here soon. I'd like to do a new, brand new girl band, a sassy young, girl band. A bit like Little Mix, Pussycat Dolls, Girls Aloud, that type of thing, but Irish. You know, but different, very modern, very fashion conscious. And I think there's room for a new boy band as well. But again, different, not the old fashioned type of band. Mm-hmm. They have to be modern, they have to be able to dance. And it's all about the fashion. Look at BTS and all these bands from Korea, you know. We can do better than that.
What do you think about social media? Do you like it?
Can I tell you the truth?
Yeah.
I'm not on Twitter, Facebook, TikTok, Instagram, nothing, nothing. I get most of my news from the Daily Mail.
Well, aren't you lucky that you're sitting in their headquarters here?
I get my news from the Daily Mail and Independent. They're my two. I don't bother with social media, but I know it's a very important part of getting a new band and that act together. They'll have to do it. Whatever, if you're in that game, you have to play it.
One thing that somebody said to me yesterday, they were like, oh, you work in television, you must be a multi-millionaire. And I thought, how unusual for people to make assumptions. And assumptions are very much, you know, what people make, whether you're famous, people think that you've limo drivers collecting you to and from. I can assure you, Louis was not driven by a limo here today.
I don't want a limo driver.
He drove himself.
But they're not even nice. Who
I think we made you a decent-ish enough cup of tea.
Who would want one?
And I think as well, you know, it's like, you know, when you talk about fame and at that level, I mean, obviously you've been very successful, you've done very well.
But
and
I know,
Lisa, crass
I know
about
it's all
it.
It's all no matter what stage you are, how big you are, it doesn't matter. You still have to do the same things as everybody else, and you still need to be grounded. You need people around you.
Yeah, and people that
and you need
love
to be healthy.
Well,
not just physically, but mentally as well.
Absolutely,
it takes a lot to go out there and do it.
100%. And you know, other things that you've said are very funny and it made me laugh actually yesterday. It's about, again, those assumptions, you know, with the money, what happens with that? What do you spend it on? And you said that your favourite book was your checkbook.
Yeah.
And I just thought it was great. Because it's like, you know, you have it, you know, and you have something to spend. What gives you a bit of joy? What do you spend it on?
I like to go to a restaurant every day, a different restaurant every day.
Oh.
I like nice cars.
You're a restaurant whore.
Yes, I am, definitely. And I go to the same places all the time in Dublin. Dublin's got great places now.
Yeah.
And I love going away when it's safe. I like to buy some art and stuff.
I heard that's a great hobby to have.
I just enjoy life. Life is for living.
That's lovely, and it's really refreshing to hear, because you know, you seem very relaxed. You seem like you're happy and you're
I'm, you know what, I'm lucky. I'm a lucky And I know
you
it.
You are, though. You
and
are.
And I know it. Yeah, I know it. Lisa. I know. You know, and I've been lucky in life, and I just enjoy it.
I suppose my final question, because obviously we could talk all day. You know, you as Louis Walsh, all that you've done over the last 30 is years plus years. My goodness, we need
to talk
about.
Let's not talk years.
Obviously, we've a new chapter to come. But I also wanted to know, what's your legacy? What would you like to leave behind?
Not very much. I want to spend my money. I don't want to leave that behind. I just want to enjoy life. I'm not looking for a legacy or anything.
Okay.
I just want to be happy and enjoy it as long as I can.
And you've such a great outlook in life
but
now,
that's true.
Which is wonderful too.
That's true.
Louis, thank you so
Lisa,
much
thank you.
For your time.
I'll come in again. We'll do a part two
we'll
in a few months.
We'll do a part two. That sounds fantastic. Louis, honestly, thank you so much. Best of luck with all your next endeavours and all to do with all the bands
Listen,
and new girl bands.
That's
I hope
all fun. That's
you.
All fun. But I mean, and life goes on. Yeah, I'm enjoying it. I can't believe I'm still getting away with it.
Listen, that is Louis Walsh right here on Spotlight. Thanks so much. Coming up on Spotlight next week, I chat exclusively to Swedish supermodel Victoria Silverstedt, who modelled in the infamous guest campaigns alongside Claudia Schiffer. She's appeared in over 500 magazine covers and was a hugely successful Playboy playmate. Victoria has plenty to say, like being good friends with Melania Trump.
And I remember she said, one day I want to be like Sophia Loren. I guess that was her style icon. And she definitely channeled that look throughout the whole 4-year term. I thought she was beautiful.
It'll be shaken and not stirred next week as finally No Time to Die is released. Don't miss our 007 special with movie critic Gordon Hayden. Before we go though, here's Grammy winner Billie Eilish's cinematic concert experience, Happier Than Ever. A love letter to Los Angeles, streaming exclusively on Disney+. I'll be back again here next week at the Gaiety Theatre, shining a light on all the entertainment that matters. I'll see you then. Take care. Bye-bye.
This is my entire album from front to back in order.
I'm not your friend or anything, damn. You think that you're the man. I think therefore I am.
I've never done anything like this. We all have these idealized versions of ourselves in our head.
You call me again, drunk in the Benz, driving home under the influence.
This is a dream come true.
Spotlight in association with Space 2. Sponsored by GLAM DOLL, bringing Hollywood home.